panel discussion will be moderated by Rod Charlie Delos Reyes, a research fellow of the UP Manila Center for Gender and Women's Studies. The first panelist is Niall Kirrane, a health service executive of the Dublin North City Mental Health Team in Ireland.
Of course, joining Niall is Ryan Lavalley, an assistant professor in the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. Also, Maria Patricia Nicole Roraldo, the founder of Filipino Occupational Therapy for Mental Health, will also share insights in the discussion together with Adrianne Louise Dominguez, a speech and language pathology undergraduate student of the University of the Philippines College of Allied Medical Professions. Now, let us hear their panel discussion.
Hi, everyone. So thank you so much for being here right now. And we are very excited to present to you our panel discussion entitled Activating the Role of Occupational Therapists and Other Healthcare Professionals Towards the LGBT Community. I know this topic is very unusual, but this is something very relevant. And I think the Global Assembly recognizes that as healthcare professionals, we have our duty and the obligation to actually talk about this and enable all people across gender spectrum. And right now, we are also very happy that a lot of our panelists agreed to have this event and to actually share some insights regarding this topic. So without further ado, okay, I'm going to be presenting to you our panelists, and I am Rod Charlie Delos Reyes, and my pronoun is he or him, and I'm going to be the facilitator for this segment. So now, let us have the introductions of our panelists. Can we have Ryan?
Hi, everyone. My name is Ryan Lavalley. I'm an assistant professor in the Division of Occupational Science and Occupational Therapy at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill in the United States. Most of my work is focused on sociopolitical and community-based occupational therapy and how we as a profession sort of understand ourselves in those realms. Most of my practice actually sits in the intersection of housing, aging, and anti-racism, but I'm also queer, and therefore I take that lens as a really important part of how I understand my work and how I understand my own identity in those sociopolitical realms. I have also done some occupational science studies with drag queens and thinking about the queer community and how occupation is used as a tool for safety creation and community building in those realms as well. So happy to be here and excited to talk about this topic.
Yeah, thank you, Ryan, so much for that. Okay, so Ryan is fresh from the United States. And now, can we have Nicole?
Hi, everyone. I'm Nicole Roraldo, and I'm an occupational therapist working in a mental health facility, which is actually working on to a wellness facility because we're trying to place it in the community for 4 years now. And my pronoun is she, her. And what I'm trying to work on is to provide like more inclusive, program for people, especially those in the LGBTQ community.
Okay. Thank you, Nicole, for that. And Niall?
Hi, everybody. My name is Niall Kirrane, and I'm an occupational therapist working here in Dublin in Ireland. My background is mainly in mental health, and most recently I've started a new position, a new OT position that has been created in the National Gender Service here in Ireland, so providing transgender healthcare for the trans and non-binary population of Ireland. I'm also involved in our professional association. So the AOTI have done a lot of work here in Ireland in terms of increasing occupational therapist confidence and skills around working with LGBT clients. So I've been involved in producing the guidelines for that. We also have an advisory group, and I'm a member of the LGBT community myself. I live here in Dublin with my boyfriend.
Great. Thank you, Niall, for that. Very interesting. And congratulations for your new position. And of course, we have here Adrianne, the youngest among the panelists. And I think her insight is going to be very interesting also. So, Adrianne.
Thank you, Charlie. Hi, everyone. My name is Adrianne Louise Dominguez. You can call me Adrianne. My pronouns are she and her. I am currently a year 3 BS speech pathology student in the University of the Philippines, Manila. Personally, I'm a mental health awareness advocate and also, of course, a gender advocate And quite recently, I was one of the country delegates to the 2021 ASEAN Korean Youth Summit, in which I mainly discussed about the social inclusion and expanding boundaries of gender sensitivity across the community. So although I am still quite learning about this as well, I hope I can provide a perspective regarding in the lens of a student and of course a future healthcare professional. Thank you.
Thank you, Adrianne. So technically, we are very glad, and I hope the participants are very excited for this panel discussion. And the goal of this panel discussion is to have a safe platform to actually discuss gender and sexuality in everyday life. And I think that should be actually imposed to a lot of our lives wherever we are. So to start off our discussion, I think one of the greatest questions that are usually talked about, or the question that is usually posed when we talk about gender and sexuality, is what are gender and sexuality, and why do some people do not conform to the binary gender? And Ryan, I think you could start the discussion with that one.
I will try. I think that this is a complex question for a variety of different reasons, but I'll start with gender and then we'll go to sexuality. Because I think that we also need to pull those two apart and often in our discussions and understanding how they're different and sort of different realms in how we approach them. But when it comes to gender, I think it's a sort of an amalgamation or a combination of social and biological and genetic and neurological and political and all these different sort of contextual factors that is how we ultimately express this thing that connects to sort of femininity, masculinity, non-binariness, you know, and both recognizing that that can be also seen differently in different cultures and contexts. But is largely constructed through our society's culture and habits and routines and sort of the expectations of different people that have largely been connected to obviously biological sex or genders that were assigned at birth. And so figuring out how to sort of play in that and understand those different ways of expressing identities through performance or even enactment of dressing or on or having your hair a certain way, moving your body in certain ways, the tone of your voice, all of these can be aspects of gender expression, but are always situated within social and political contexts. So we have to remember that for those of us who are part of communities that are oppressed or marginalized, that gender expression is often a political act. And so we have to understand ourselves in that realm as we do our everyday life and think about our occupations. Similarly with sexuality, I would say that it is sort of an expression of attraction and doesn't always talk about genitals. It's one of the first things to know. Is sexuality can come in many different forms and even not really be related to sex, but thinking about romance and connection and attraction and can be expressed in lots of different ways. And again, is sort of situationally relevant based on different political and social expectations of different bodies and how that can be understood, I think. Given the different types of bodies that are out there and the different ways that people like to engage in their sensations and sexuality is also a gift of the queer community, in that we have really pushed for us to be more open to and understanding and celebrating those different ways of finding pleasure and connecting and creating sort of opportunities for people to come together and really understand how we can provide pleasure in those ways. So that is, I don't know if that's maybe too abstract, but I welcome any further development or understanding of those concepts.
Thank you, Ryan, for that. Niall?
Yeah, well done, Ryan. I think that was a very good explanation. I would just like to add, I guess, that, yeah, if I think about it in how it affects maybe people that we work with as healthcare professionals, for me, I would view them as, you know, facets or aspects of the person's identity. I think it's different for every person how, you know, important those aspects are of their identity in terms of their sexual attraction, their orientation, or their gender identity. But I think it is important to acknowledge them, that they, you know, everybody has them, I guess, and lives with them. They're experienced very differently by people. But I think it's important, yeah, not to be, you know, I've heard terms around, you know, kind of that kind of blindness, which has come up a lot, I know, in kind of racial conversations recently. And also I've heard it in terms of sexual orientation kind of conversations recently, that, you know, it's kind of sexual orientation blind or sexuality blind. And I think that can be often a mistake. I think people growing up, particularly of LGBT identities, they're part of a minority group. They have unique kind of lived experiences, I think, growing up in that way. And they therefore have specific considerations, I think, that need to be considered. But I think overall being part of the LGBT community is, in my experience, an amazing thing. It offers connection and community and culture, and it's very much part of identity that could and should be celebrated, I think.
Thank you, Niall, for that very good insight. How about Nicole?
Yeah, I just want to add to that, because recently I've read about the gingerbread person, which, well, it doesn't necessarily like differentiate gender or sexuality, but it provides a more simple way of understanding sex and identity, expression, and of course our orientation, where sex is what you are biologically provided with at birth, so male and female, or like with your organs, and then identity is how you identify yourself or how you feel, whether or not it's female or male. Please do correct me though. And expression is how you express yourself, your attitudes, your actions, how you look, like how you do your hair, that's what you said a while ago. And of course orientation is how you're attracted to others or who you like. So there. So I guess that's a good way of putting it as well.
Thank you, Nicole, for that insights and that definitions, actually, because I think a lot of our participants or some people actually confuses this terminologies every now and then, right? Adrianne, do you have anything to add with regards with gender and sexuality?
Right. Actually, what they said earlier, it just mainly showing us that sex and sexuality and gender, of course, it's a complex matter, and it's not simply qualitatively identify a person into such a label and then judge them for that label specifically, because it exists in so many contexts, so many social, political, and, you know, personal contexts that only you can identify and understand as a person yourself. And I feel like when it comes to the second question, that I think it's regarding to the why people do not conform in a binary, what was the word?
Binary gender stereotypes or binary male.
Yeah. Binary gender stereotypes. It's not really they deliberately do not conform to it, although some people might do. However, it's just a way of expressing yourself. You know, having that binary gender stereotypes, it's what we are born into. It's a socially constructed expectations of that's built upon history, political influences, and cultural influences that we live in. Therefore, when we as a person know ourselves and identify ourselves, regardless in that whatever classification or stereotype that we live in, it's simply because we are who we are. And it's not because it's not anyone's fault to be in that way. And it's not their fault that they do not confide in that, you know, certain categorization of life, which of course we shouldn't do, because people are complex beings and we should recognize that and respect that.
Yeah, so those are very interesting definitions of gender and sexuality. And I do agree with Adrianne that it's very multifaceted, that sometimes with this just few panelists, it's defined with a lot of terms. But one thing is very common, that it's sometimes socially constructed. It involves politics, it involves your position in the society and so on. And I think that is actually something that we should be recognizing, that people are not, should not be put into a box of this male or female and so on. And at some point, I like the idea of it's not their fault, because they are just them as they are eventually. And I guess that is very interesting to start off our panel discussion. And I think some of the people would be very interested on what would you say on this next question in regards to, if do you think this segment, what we're doing right now, is important to talk about in everyday life? And how is this topic relevant to your space or in your own context, or specifically in your own country? Ryan, I think you would want to start off with that one.
I can jump in, and I'd actually just want to sort of come off of the end of the other question and recognize that when we talk about social construction, gender and sexuality are both, it's not that it's not real. A lot of times people are like, oh, it's just a social construct, but it's very real. But by socially constructed, we mean that we are creating this idea together as community and through politics and social relationships that are very real and have real consequences for different populations in those systems and ways that we interact. So as much as gender and sexuality are social constructs, they're also very much embodied and connected to the way that we live out our lives in real and consequential ways. I would also say that, you know, people, this is not a choice, you know, most of the time, I would say like 99% of the time, you know, there's some people who like to play in different things, and they're choosing that, but most of the time, you know, this is a real coming to yourself and figuring out yourself and you know, just because that self is different than those other systems and society's rules doesn't mean that we are just deciding to go against them in some ways. And so for me, I think this is a really important conversation just for that reason, in that there are health disparities, there are different experiences, there are you know, real issues that are facing the queer community and gender diverse people from a mental health perspective, as well as just having access to things like gender affirming surgeries or things like that through our healthcare systems, and learning how to go through those transition processes, or you know, having a spinal cord injury and being able to talk about how to self-pleasure or how to engage with your partner in sexual practices that are safe and still accessible to you. And so we want people to be able to engage in those everyday lives, and there are real political and policy and social stigmas around these issues that prevent people from living out the fullest lives. For me, I'm coming from a US context where I would say we have progressed quite far, particularly since the 1980s. And thank you so much to the generation in front of us for doing so much work in the US around the AIDS epidemic and sort of the different political acts that they had to put their bodies through to really bring forward some of the activism and work of our community, but particularly for trans women of color, as leaders in this realm, and really pushing the queer community at large to consider these intersectionalities and larger issues broadly. And so for me, it's, being queer is very political still. It's more accepted in the US, and we see drag queens in mainstream TV now. but I think there's still very real work that is needed to be done to address the less acceptable, you know, people. The white cis gay men in our world are super accepted, and now it's kind of cool in certain ways, but we cannot leave our brothers and sisters and siblings who are non-binary, who maybe are trans or people of color in the queer community behind. So I think that's the work in the US that we really have to do, is understanding that inclusivity in the queer community.
Thank you, Ryan, for that very good contextualization in the United States. And I guess here in the Philippines, Philippines is basically known as one of the gay-friendliest countries in Asia. But Can we have some insights, Adrianne, I think?
Yes, thanks, Charlie, for, you know, saying that. Because when we think about it, the Philippines is traditionally, you know, a patriarchal community. And a lot of the population really affirm to Christian beliefs that has binary stereotypes in gender and sexuality. So I guess it's important very much to talk about this because we need to normalize talking about our sexuality, our gender, and being able to visibly display yourself and, you know, just live your life as you are, because it's very difficult to hide yourself in a closet and not be, you know, secretly judged by people around you. That maybe they could be open about it in public, but in the back of their minds, there's still, you know, maybe judgment or prejudices that cloud their thoughts. And as a youth, I guess it's very important that we could recognize that there are differences and it exists in our daily lives, and we should recognize that and treat them with respect, because it's what we want from other people as well, right? I specifically remember that one of my friends wanted to buy a rainbow pin, but they decided not to. And then I asked them, oh, why? Why so? You liked it. It's cute, right? But then they said, oh, maybe they thought, they think that I'm gay. And then I told, I'm not going to say their pronouns, but yeah, I told my friend that, why is that a problem to you? We need to unpack that why being gay is a bad thing when it's not. It's just someone's identity. And in small conversations like that we can start among friends, eventually around our families, we get to talk about these things and, you know, normalize it and mainstream it in media, in our policies, in education, because this is reality. And, you know, as the times are changing, we are more open to it, right? And that's a good thing, because we embrace diversity nowadays. And maybe it's difficult to have progression from a closeted community or a more traditional community, but, you know, taking the baby steps of talking about it with the people you're comfortable with, just your friends and your family, just talking about it in everyday life, just recognizing that it exists also helps in expanding the views of society in general.
Okay, that is very insightful, Adrianne, and that is coming from the generation right now, and it's good to hear actually those insights. Niall, how about in Ireland or in European countries? How is this topic relevant in your space and in your context?
Yeah, I guess Europe culturally is quite distinctive even in each country. So I can probably only speak to Ireland in my own kind of context. But I think, yeah, it's ever unfolding conversation here in Ireland. Thankfully, in like recent years, there's been a huge amount of social change and I would say social progression around kind of topics of gender and sexuality. But of course, Ireland is a historically very Catholic country, and the grip of the Catholic Church has been very tight on this country right up until my generation, I would say. So my parents' generation would all still be quite devoutly Catholic and grew up in a very, I guess, a society where there isn't much separation of church and state. Even to this day, most schools in Ireland are still actually run by the Catholic Church in some way. So you can imagine the ideological maybe challenges that poses. So for example, like in recent years, there's been a huge amount of changes, but it's all come about maybe in the last 20, 30 years. So in 1993, it was still illegal to be gay in Ireland, to be homosexual. That's within my lifetime. I was 3 or 4 years old at that point. It changed in 1993, that law was abolished. But then kind of all of a sudden, since the mid-90s, we've leapfrogged ahead in some ways. We've become quite progressive. In 2015, we legalized same-sex marriage. In 2018, we finally secured abortion rights and bodily autonomy for women. So these are huge steps forward for a society that not that long ago was, you know, deeply Catholic and very much embedded still with the church. So that's been really great to see, but you know, it is still an unfolding conversation. That doesn't mean that everybody in Ireland is on board with it, although both of those big moves were decided by public referendum, which was a very nice thing that it was, you know, put to democracy, and democracy spoke in favor of those things. But yeah, there are definitely still pockets and places in Ireland. There's an urban-rural divide, maybe, or just, you know, there are still lots of dynamics at play. And I think within, to relate it back to why it's important to have these conversations and events like this kind of globally and nationally, I really noticed it in healthcare circles, in OT circles, that any of the knowledge and insights that I had, I felt were through my own membership of the LGBT community and not necessarily through things I learned in college or curriculum or training. So therefore, if you're someone who doesn't have access to those networks or communities just through your social circles or where you're living, maybe you don't know what you need to know about these topics, or you don't have, you know, you don't know gay people or trans people to, you know, put a reality to kind of these very theoretical debates and charged debates that you hear in the media sometimes. So that's why I think events like this are great. It's great to be having these conversations within occupational therapy circles specifically. And yeah, that's where a lot of our work with AOTI has been, around helping other therapists, mainly OTs, but also other health and social care professionals here, to start talking and learning and building competence and confidence in this area.
Yeah, thank you, Niall, for that. Those are very nice words, and I think that is also a challenge for the participants, because a lot of the participants or the people who are wanted to talk about this topic is a little bit problematic with confidence, because they don't know actually how to access information, or they don't know how to actually advocate with this one, but they have that intent. And that is very interesting, and how I wish that a lot of countries would be Ireland in a very quick, progressive way eventually as well. Nicole, do you have anything to add with that? How important, or is it important to talk about this one, and how is this relevant? Specifically, I think, in mental health here in the Philippines.
Thanks. I think there's a lot to talk about. Let's say we start off with revolving around client-centeredness, because there's a lot of problems in terms of people, especially those in the double marginalized population. If you're a person probably with schizophrenia and you're also in the LGBTQIA community, how are you to access that particular you know, program? Are you discriminated because you're part of the LGBTQIA, or because you're part of the mental health crisis, or both? So talking about this in different marginalized populations sort of comes into play, that we have to convince people that it's still about acceptance, and it's still about being able to enable people to practice their rights and to become an enabler by talking about it, to say that even though you don't personally experience these discriminations or other things that they might experience, you are there to support and to not add to the problem of those who are actually helping this discrimination and other, you know, disparities for this marginalized population. Which is very important.
Yes, thank you, Nicole, for that one. And what I pick up with your sharing is about, I think something that the participants and everyone who is watching right now is, acceptance and tolerance is two different things, I guess. And I think the Philippines is at some point very tolerant about the LGBT community and other people in the other spectrum of gender. But I think we should be working also with acceptance eventually, because it's another thing, and it is actually detrimental for some people who are actually encountering a double jeopardy or double marginalization with mental health and so on. So yeah. And eventually, I think Niall and Nicole and the rest actually share their some insights as a professional, as an occupational therapist, and of course, as a student. So basically, as with your work, okay, so what do you think is your role towards the LGBT plus community? And I think I'll go ahead with the person with a new role in this field, Niall.
Sure. Yeah, I'm happy to start the ball rolling on this one. I was just thinking there of a conference that I presented at a few years ago when we launched the good practice guidelines. And at the very beginning of the presentation, let's say there was 100 people in the room, I'm not sure, but I remember who of those therapists, all OTs, who had worked with an LGBT client at some point in their career. So did they think they had worked with someone from the LGBT community? And inevitably, I think everybody in the room put their hand up, because such is the diversity of life and of society. But then when I asked, I guess, who had actually ever had training or education or inclusion of this in their, let's say, OT formative training, I think two people put up their hand out of the entire room. So for me, that kind of shows that I guess OTs are, of course, in their practice, encountering people from the LGBT community all the time, but maybe aren't best equipped yet to work with them and to have all the cultural sensitivities that they need to have. I think that's across all areas of OT practice, and that was one of the messages we tried to get through with our guidelines, was that, you know, you LGBT people are just part of society. There's a rough statistic of 1 in 10 ish, right, or something, likely more, and so you are very likely to encounter LGBT people in all aspects, whether you're working in, you know, acute care, in mental health, in pediatric services, and sometimes I think their gender identity or their sexual orientation might be the focus of your intervention and of your work. So I know working in mental health, that has been the case with some clients I've worked with, helping them to explore their gender identity or to become more comfortable maybe with their sexual orientation. But often I think for OTs, it also won't be the focus of your work, but you still need to be aware of it. You need to be aware of language and concepts and to make sure that you're providing culturally sensitive kind of healthcare and occupational therapy. To speak a little bit about my own role here, I guess I'm in a privileged position that I've got to make this kind of my full-time job as opposed to just an aspect of my role. So recently the National Gender Service here in Ireland has, I guess, adopted a new model of care, and it's very much a multidisciplinary one. So we have a full multidisciplinary team with, you know, everybody, all allied health professionals represented on it. OT is the newest member to the team and the latest seat at the table. But I think talking about kind of transgender healthcare in specific, you know, people access our service looking for gender affirming healthcare. So often hormones, often surgery, but we provide, I guess, a lot more holistic care than that also. And I think people on the team were seeing that there was just a lot of functional difficulties often in the clients maybe that were coming into us. So not everybody, lots of people come in functioning at a really good level and sail through the process, but some other people, maybe 1/3 of our kind of clients, need a bit of extra support. And I guess particularly if you're living as like questioning your gender, if you're exploring your gender, if you're not yet able to start transitioning because of lots of potential barriers maybe that are outside your control, either in your family life, your relationships, just where you live, your culture, then it can be really tricky, and people can become quite occupationally deprived, I think, sometimes not engaging in the occupations that they love. Their choice in what occupations maybe are very restricted or dictated by their gender. And then I think when, you know, as you transition, as people transition, it's gender transition, but I think there's also a huge transition of occupations, of roles, of responsibilities. And that's, I guess, my role on the team, is to try and help people navigate those kind of occupational transitions. And Brenda Began from Canada has a lovely article about it back in 2012, I think, about, you know, saying there will be some occupational losses and sacrifices, but there will also be lovely gains and new occupations and new roles gained. So I guess I'm helping people who are maybe getting a bit stuck in the middle, who have maybe lost or compromised on some occupations and role loss, but then haven't quite rediscovered new ones yet. So that's kind of my role here. It's not very common, like I haven't encountered many other OTs as yet working directly in gender services. I hope there will be more of us. There are some in the NHS in the UK, and if there are any watching this global assembly, I would love to hear from you as well, so we can connect a little bit. Yeah, they would be my insights into the role.
Okay, that is very interesting, and I guess that would be really interesting to have those new roles for occupational therapists and other healthcare professionals that are designated for affirmative healthcare or eventually advocacy on just gender equality and so on. So that's really interesting, Niall. How about you, Adrianne? I think some insight from a student and of course a future professional, of course, eventually, what are your insights with the possible role of us or you towards the LGBT community?
Right, I feel like as a health professional and healthcare in general, we should see our future or my future patients and possibly your patients in a holistic manner. And thankfully, in the University of the Philippines, for allied health professionals such as OTs, PTs, physical therapists, and speech pathologists like me, we actually we are being taught to use the WHO ICF framework, which is where you use the International Classification of Functioning Health and Disability. So in general, it's a framework wherein you look at your patient or your client in a more holistic manner, not only based on their medical diagnosis, but also their environmental and personal factors, which include, of course, your sexuality and your gender. So I feel like it's important that even students like me and, you know, future health professionals generally have a training or at least a lecture on gender sensitivity, because inevitably we will find clients who are in the LGBTQ community, and we must be able to cater their needs and their identity in general. We must be able to understand where they're coming from and what they need and are expecting from us. And aside from that, I feel like in general, it's so difficult to find healthcare statistics for the LGBTQ community. Like thinking about it in the cases that I find or in statistics that I need from the internet, it's so hard to see statistics or consensus from that part of the society. So I guess there's also that gap in where we don't really know what the specific needs or the unique needs that the LGBTQ community has. And we need to address that, because that gap, as long as it's there, there's already a disparity on the healthcare services that we could provide. So I think in general, we need more studies and more attention to that, as well as having gender-affirming healthcare. Because when you have gender-affirming healthcare, your clients could be more comfortable in finding help, especially when it comes to medical help and mental health kind of help. So in general, this helps and contributes to a patient's general well-being. And as, you know, OTs, as health professionals, and as service providers, we should be able to recognize these and address it properly by having, you know, the right education and background on how to deal with these kind of cases. So there's that.
Yeah, so thank you, Adrianne, for that. I think Adrianne and Niall actually contributed a lot in discussing the role of us an occupational therapist and a healthcare professional towards patient care and client care eventually in clinics. And I think Ryan could actually add up on another perspective or another role of as an educator or someone that is.
Yeah, I was actually going to talk about research. I think Adrianne brings up a really good point in that we need more studies and we need to understand the LGBTQ community more in depth than we do, both looking at some of those disparities and needs, but also finding the ways that we can celebrate the things that we learn and cultivate through participation in everyday life as a queer person. And so that's sort of been my realm in thinking about how we leverage everyday life as a tool in therapeutic processes, as not just an ends that we're trying to get people to be able to participate in occupations that are gender affirming or that allow them to express their sexuality, but rather to understand occupations that are done through that lens and through that experience as strengths, as something that maybe queer people can teach some straight people some things, you know, about life and about how we move through the world. And so understanding everyday life through that lens as a tool, I think, is the foundation of occupational therapy in its inception. But we are sort of taking a bent that challenges some of those original assumptions about what that looks like, based on some of the normative ways we've understood sort of productivity and what is good activity and not. So I just think there's something there as well, and not just researching the needs of our community, but researching the things that we bring to the world that no one else does as a queer community. So we have a lot of assets and strengths that need to be explored and celebrated through research, and occupational science and occupational therapy very much can do that.
Yeah, that's very interesting, Ryan. And I really like that. It's sometimes you do need to do research to find needs or to find problems. And sometimes you just need to just celebrate. And that is very interesting insight from you. Nicole, I think that you're working a lot with occupational justice and so on. So I think you could give an insight on how, as a healthcare professional, you're a little bit obligated still to actually enable justice and so on eventually. Any thoughts, Nicole?
Thank you. So actually, in the Philippines, there's what we call gender responsiveness. There's a lot of programs regarding this, but then we're not yet onto the other members of the LGBTQIA majority. We're focusing on equality for women and equality for men, but not necessarily the totality of the community. So I think the way that we can take part in the role of enabling people is there's actually a tripartite role for occupational therapists, and we've discovered this for substance abuse, but I think this is also good for the LGBTQ community. The first one is we are promoters of occupational participation, with which I think Niall and Ryan and Adrianne had already talked about how people can actually transition themselves and, you know, promoting, enabling themselves as who they are, how they express themselves with autonomy and with real veracity with that. And so once we are enabled with that particular way, we are also collaborators to enhance participation and well-being to others. So it's not just me and the person, but it's also the person and those around the person. So we're working at trying to help them see how this person sees him or herself. So that's also one thing. And facilitators of the environment. So aside from research, of course, policies are very, very much important. I'm just gonna go back to the, you know, double marginalization again, because in the mental health policies, there aren't much policies that actually safeguard people in the LGBTQIA. And so I think that's very important.
Yeah, I guess Nicole was trying to say that policies are very important eventually on these items. And I think there's a lot of like gender equality and so on, but it's more focused, especially here in the Philippines, towards women empowerment, equality with patriarchal society and so on. But the people who belong to the non-binary individuals are a little bit not stipulated or not explicitly written in these laws, and at some point it places them in some a little bit less fortunate positions eventually. So thank you so much for those sharing about the different roles of occupational therapists and healthcare professionals eventually with the LGBT plus community. And I think you were able to share some roles of what we do or what we aspire to do eventually. This question is a little bit towards Niall, I guess, because you've been working with this one. So how do you work around with the LGBT community or for the others, if not yet given the chance to actually approach this opportunity to work with the LGBT community? How would you approach, if given a chance, LGBT community in healthcare or eventually in everyday life? Niall first?
Yeah, I think, like, there's a lot of different ways. Talking about gender and sexuality are not always the easiest subjects to discuss, both as the client and perhaps also as a therapist. We have our own discomforts with raising those kind of topics. But I know that even before you ever are sitting with the client, there's lots of work you can do to make sure that your practice is LGBT inclusive. So you can think about your kind of public messaging and signaling in terms of in the waiting room or in the kind of public spaces of your practice or in your therapy rooms, what kind of things you're displaying. You know, if you're displaying lots of posters of, let's say, couples or families or things, are there diverse people in it, both in terms of sexualities and in terms of gender identities? One of the things that was kind of one of the big tips that we had in our guidelines was around considering your public profile and thinking about the power, I guess, that having, let's say, a rainbow flag or some kind of symbolism in your office or on you. I don't have it now, but we all wear, our trusty rainbow lanyards that we have for our work badges, you know. So just small things like that. I think lots of people maybe don't notice them, you know, maybe if you're not part of the LGBT community, you don't notice them, or you just think they're nice colors or something. But I think for people who need to see that stuff, symbolism like that can really help. So particularly here in Ireland, maybe if you have older people, so people of a generation that, you know, was before a lot of that societal change that I talked about earlier, who would be not out, you know, perhaps living still closeted or kind of separating, I guess, aspects of their lives, they mightn't talk about their sexual orientation or gender identity with, like, friends and family, never mind with a healthcare professional who, certainly in the past, there would have been maybe a bit of a power dynamic there. So I think even before you sit down, just small things like that, having kind of some symbolism can just signal that it's a safe space. And then there is maybe some reluctance to talk about it, but just, I guess, in terms of your language, really, as OTs and health professionals, I think we just need to really upskill and make sure our language and our questioning is inclusive. So, you know, maybe asking somebody if they're in a relationship, let's say, as opposed to presuming the gender or the sex of their partner. Small things like that on our documentation, like around assessments and things like that, making sure that there's a lot of inclusive options for all gender identities. Asking, is it even relevant to gather data on, you know, the gender of the person? Is that always a necessary question to ask? For some, like, sometimes it is, and so it's relevant to some settings and healthcare practices, but in other areas maybe it's not so relevant. So I think beginning to question even why we do things like that. There's lots of things. I don't know, I could talk about policy, as you guys have already said, but I better let somebody else maybe give their thoughts on it as well. We have a 4 P's model that we use, 4 P's of inclusive practice in the guidelines. And it goes something like your public profile, your policy and procedures, programs then. So thinking about if there are specific maybe programs, interventions, groups that you need to offer that would be of benefit to that specific client group. And then finally, professional development. So identifying what gaps there are, maybe in knowledge or skills, and finding ways to proactively address them so that staff members can be more comfortable and confident in being providing inclusive practice.
So that, those are very interesting. And I guess what I got from Niall is there are a lot of small things that we could actually do to create an inclusive and affirmative healthcare, or eventually just interaction with the LGBT plus community. And those are really interesting. Any thoughts, Adrianne or Ryan?
I would say one thing that is important to remember is that you'll never know everything. And so the way in which you approach that conversation is really important. And so having as much information as you can before going into those spaces, whether it's about the different language that people use or the different equipment options that are there for different gender expressions or prosthetics and the different sort of contraindications or things like that related to those different equipment pieces, you know, having that there and thinking about it. But if somebody comes to you and says, you know, I'm really into this thing, this kink or something, and, you know, just asking questions or being able to step into that conversation without awkwardness, because you're the one that is really going to open up a space that is direct and honest, but also affirming. And so not being so afraid to open a conversation because you feel like you're not prepared, you know, do some preparation, do the work beforehand, but you won't know everything. And so being able to like ask a question or, you know, if you're talking about, this is just from personal experience, like asking me about, you know, how I have sex is like super awkward for many healthcare. They're like, are you this or are you that? And so, you know, becoming comfortable with language that makes sense or makes someone feel like you get it. You can say top, bottom, verse, you know, or just like asking some languages of like, you know, how do you want to have sex again? You know, and allowing that person to talk you through it in a more neutral way. Or how do you want to express your gender or those sorts of things, I think are just important habits to build as a therapist so that you can, without any hesitation, step into those conversations a little bit more comfortably, knowing that you don't know everything and knowing that asking and having real conversations is part of the game.
Can I just echo that again, Ryan? That's a really, really good point. I think, like, you know, there are, of course, there's things you need maybe to upskill in and language and concepts, but yeah, not, you'll never know everything. And ultimately, I think client-centeredness is a universal aspect of occupational therapy, a kind of core premise of it. And so if you're practicing and operating in a client-centered way, I don't think you can go too far wrong. You know, like if you use that as your basic guiding principle, you'll meet the person where they're at, let them inform you of things you don't know. And I think that's a really nice part of our profession, that we approach things that way, and it makes this work easier.
Thank you, Niall and Ryan, for that. Nicole, do you have any thoughts regarding how would you work around the LGBT community if you're given a chance, or if you had some tips also for the participants or the viewers as of the moment?
I think they've already touched on it. The best part is to never stop learning. So, you know, it's and also to present yourself as a safe, affirming space for anyone who will approach you, and to not judge them for what they look like, how they think, you know, how they want to be called, to have evidence-informed opinion about several things, about policies, about, you know, that will help them move around that space comfortably and not feel different from you. So, and then of course, guided by the principles of course, code of ethics, you know, beneficence is always one of the things that you have to push forward for every time you meet somebody, whether or not you're comfortable with how they present themselves to you. So there, I think that's it.
Thank you, Nicole, for that. Do you have anything to add, Adrianne?
I don't really have anything to add because I'm learning myself. And I feel like all of them gave very good examples on how to make a gender-affirming workspace. And, you know, it's good to ask questions, and it's the safest way to approach anything is to ask your client or your patient the questions and to have themselves open up to you, and you yourself should be open to them as well.
Yeah, thank you, Adrianne, for that. So basically how we create an affirmative healthcare, gender affirmative healthcare. It's being more sensitive and being more like client-centered, because what like Niall said a while ago, if you go client-centered, you'll never go wrong with that one, but it's okay to create mistakes at some point, because mistakes actually makes us better, I think. And at some point when we're actually still or starting to navigate clients or people with who belongs in the non-binary population, eventually we'll be able to learn more, and being open to learn with them, I guess that would be a very good thing to actually work with them eventually in the future or so on. And I guess this next question is all anyone who wants to actually volunteer themselves to answer, but this is a very curious and interesting question, I guess. It's more on what is allyship and how can you be a true ally? Because I think some people would just say that if you have a rainbow pin or you go post during the Pride Month or so on like that, then you're a true ally already and so on. But what do you think about this one? How do you navigate about allyship? I mean, anyone from the group can unmute themselves and go on.
I will just start with that when I talk about allyship, one, I always recognize that allyship requires a risk from those people. It's usually not something that's super comfortable. So if you're comfortable in your allyship, you might want to challenge yourself a little bit further. But I also would say that the first step of allyship is deciding whether you're the right person to be in that space, and seeing a moment where you aren't, and that's okay. And to go find someone who is better suited or more connected to that community. So for example, if I were working in a hospital and one of my colleagues were to go to a client who was gender non-conforming and they don't have a lot of experience with that, and they know that I do, to ask that client if they would rather have someone who does have more experience serve them, you know, or even a doctor, like if a doctor said, oh, we have an out queer doctor here, would you prefer to be served by them? You know, I think that's a question we all have to answer. As therapists, we also always want to be helping, but sometimes you're not the right person to be helping. And that's the first step of allyship, is to recognize when you are not the right person to be helping. If you are the only person there, then, you know, there's lots of different things that you can do. And part of that is learning and understanding these things. But that's just always the point that I generally start with when it comes to allyship, just to pause that helping attitude a little bit and say, you know, first decide whether you're the right person to help.
Thank you, Ryan, for that. That is very interesting. And I think that is sometimes being forgotten by a lot of people because they really want to help out. But I think it's more on towards yourself initially and like putting yourself into the spotlight eventually. Anyone, any other else from the group?
Yeah, I think you made the point, Charlie, which was really good. And it's a fear of mine is with the, you know, proliferation of things like the rainbow lanyard that I just showed you or the pride pins and things like that. My slight bit of fear with them is that somebody goes to see a therapist or somebody who's wearing one of those pins and still has a really negative healthcare experience based on their LGBT identity. And I think that is probably happening and might well happen, not intentionally, I would hope. But I think it is like one of those things of, yeah, doing the work, as Ryan says, asking yourself if you're the best person to be, you know, positioning yourself in that allyship. And then I think on a broad level, just like trusting lived experience, you know, like as an ally, maybe you're saying, okay, yeah, I don't have that lived experience that you have. So then trust the person who has lived experience would be my basic sentiment, I think, on how to be a good ally. Yeah, maybe those three words.
Thank you so much for those insights about allyship. So I know a lot of the participants and viewers as of the moment really want to extend eventually our segment for today, but I think as they have started the conversation, gender and sexuality is a little bit complex and it does not just, you'll never understand it in just a single sitting or in just an hour of discussion, but I guess you'll be able to contact every one of us eventually, if you have more questions or if you have any more insights or if you want to promote discussions also with this one. But before we actually part or end this segment about our panel discussion about activating the role of occupational therapists and other healthcare professionals towards the LGBT community, I would want each one of you to show or like have a parting message or like something to give to the participants regarding this topic or regarding this discussion eventually. Can we have go ahead? Any one of you who wants to go ahead? I don't want to put pressure. Adrianne, go ahead.
Yeah, it's very nice to talk about these things and more openly learn about it, especially with experts such as you guys. And I hope the rest of our audience also had a good perspective on what sexuality and gender is. And in general, I just feel like you should be able to accept and openly be a safe space for people of all genders and people of all sexualities, because I feel like the respect that we give them is also the respect that we allow other people to have for us. And in general, it's all just people being people, you know, we're all complex human beings, and maybe sexuality and gender is a part of their personality and identity, but it's not the only part of their identity and their personality, you know, as a person. And we must recognize that in order to provide the adequate care and, of course, in healthcare and services that we're going to give them, we must recognize this and respect their own identities as well. So thank you for everyone who shared their insights here, and I hope everyone learned something new.
Thank you, Adrianne, for that very good message. Can we have Niall?
Yeah, sure. It's been a pleasure taking part today, Charlie. Thanks for organizing this, and yeah, looking forward to the 2 days of the assembly itself. I think my parting message would be, you know, that everybody has a potential role to play in this. So whether you're, you know, watching this as an educator or as a clinician or as a student, these are, you know, it's good to just get this thought processes going. Maybe it's something you've been thinking about for a while, or maybe this is, you know, this global assembly is the first time you've kind of thought about it. So yeah, I think everybody has a part, and you can maybe take one or two very small steps after this event to start thinking about what I'm going to do for it. If you're an educator, having a look at your curriculum, seeing how embedded this kind of stuff is in the curriculums, what research programs are there around it. If you're a therapist, looking at policies and programs on the ground that affect both yourself and your clients. And I think just continuing to network, like being a member of kind of the SexGen OTOS network has been hugely enjoyable for me over the last year or so, and just over the last year or two, mainly since I joined Twitter, I think, finding OTs, so other OTs who are already in your OT tribe, but then this kind of subsection then of people of OTs who are also interested in gender and sexuality. It's really enriching, like to speak with you all today and to be part of the wider global conversation on this. So thanks for having me.
Thank you, Niall, for that. Nicole?
Thank you. This conversation has been really refreshing for me. To be honest, in the beginning, I was not really very confident talking about this because, we don't really talk about it. But having this experience now with you gives me more confidence to get the word out there that there's a lot more that we could do for the LGBTQIA community. And if you feel that you're still not comfortable talking about it, it's okay. Take your time, but do talk about it. Be more enlightened. So there.
Thank you, Nicole. Ryan?
Also, thank you so much for having me, and it's wonderful to connect with all of you. I'm pretty sure I've already followed some of you on Instagram and Twitter. We are already connected. But excited to have these conversations. I will say that for those allies out there, it is tiring to constantly advocate and constantly be pushing. And so I think that's a space for you in recognizing that, yes, we can use our lived experience to do this advocacy work, but standing alongside of us and putting the energy into sort of moving what we're saying forward in a way that is not sort of overstepping in front of us, but sort of being alongside us is a really powerful way to get engaged in the work. But it's also very energy draining to constantly share your lived experience. And we have to think about that as well with our clients. And so I would say for me, a parting message, you know, we always talk about the golden rule being, you know, treat others the way you want to be treated. And frankly, I think that's really problematic because some people definitely don't want to be treated the way I want to be treated. And so really we talk about sort of goofily like the platinum rule, which is treat others they want to be treated. And I think that's a really important way to understand this practice, is that you ask and you learn and you treat that person and celebrate them in a way that matches the way they understand themselves, and see the ways that we can allow people to flourish through their occupations rather than really looking to solve problems or needs that they have, but really looking beyond that to a nourishment and flourishing based on their own understanding of their identity and their wellness. So I just encourage people to broaden and learn and expand how they support others in really coming to their own realizations rather than what we might expect being the therapist.
Thank you, Ryan, for that very good words. And I think our participants are very happy on listening and actually hearing a lot of insights from the rest of you. And I think what I could actually say that is we should celebrate each individuality. And I think we should never stop learning. And that's a very powerful message, that sometimes we don't know everything. And it's really nice to actually get to know other people. And every one of us are really different, and it takes a lot of courage to know other people. But don't always, yes, it's okay that it is not yet your time to be understanding or knowing this thing, but at some point you need to. Okay, and I think gender and sexuality is something we are unusual, specifically here in the Philippines, but this is very relevant. And at some point we need to push each other together up instead of like ignoring these messages and ignoring these unusual topics, which is actually relevant and at some point need to be highlighted every now and then, especially in everyday life. Because in everyday life, we express gender, we express and we do everything that we do based on what we are as an individual, as a person. And thank you everyone for listening, and thank you for all our panelists for today. So thank you and see you soon, and enjoy the whole global assembly.
Wow, thank you, Niall, Ryan, Nicole, and Adrianne, for sharing your valuable insights and perspectives on the role of occupational therapists and other professionals for the LGBTQIA+ community. There is much to learn from your rich discussion. In fact, participants are interacting, asking questions, and sharing perspectives in the live question and answer chat. If I may just share, one question was on, should occupational therapists be professionally expected to deliver OT services that might conflict with their own beliefs, prejudice, and faith? For instance, if someone's faith belief is against gender confirmation and your legally male client's goals include putting on makeup and dressing up as traditionally female clothes, what should be professionally expected for these OT professionals? And that's a very, very valid question. And our esteemed panelists, they are here with us. And Niall and Ryan recognize that conflicts on personal and professional values of a professional and with their client indeed really happen and occur in practice. They share that putting the client in the center of our care is very essential. Such conflicts in values at different levels may be challenging to deal with, really. And this reflects the importance of communicating that we are allies of our clients as long as it is not at the expense of our own safety and human and legal rights as an individual. So we invite everyone, all of our participants, to share your insights as well. Ask your burning questions and share best practices in the Q&A chat. We have a live Q&A platform here in the assembly. And certainly, there is a need to activate the role of occupational therapists and other professionals for the LGBTQIA+ community. We are one with all our panelists in ringing this call to action for all professionals to create safe spaces for our community and to implement innovative, inclusive, and effective strategies to promote gender and sexuality in everyday life across cultures and populations. So I just want to take this opportunity to recognize our esteemed panelists. They will be spotlighted for everyone to see. I would like to recognize Niall Kirrane. I hope that we can give him a round of applause, virtual round of applause for Niall. Hi, Niall.
Hello. Nice to see you all. Good morning.
We also have Ryan Lavalley with us here.
Hello, everyone. Great to be here. Good morning.
I would also like to recognize Maria Patricia Nicole Roraldo as one of our panelists, and Adrianne Louise Dominguez, who is also here with us today. So thank you very much. To show our appreciation to our esteemed panelists, we award the certificate of appreciation that reads, let us just share the certificate that we'll be giving our panelists. All right, the 2021 Global Assembly on Everyday Life, Gender, and Sexuality presents this certificate of appreciation to all of you in grateful appreciation of being our speakers during this Global Assembly on Everyday Life, Gender, and Sexuality organized by the UP Manila Center for Gender and Women's Studies in partnership with the SexGen Autos, held on October 29 to 30 via Zoom. Thank you so much for your very wonderful insights. We hope that this sparks a lot of conversations until tomorrow in our panel parallel sessions. I hope that we would also have you there. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you so much for the rest of the panelists, and thank you, Ma'am Charm, for that very good insight and summary of that panel discussion. So.